Good morning. My name is Diane Dimkoff, and I'm the Research Customer Support Coordinator. Welcome to the first day of the 2014 Virtual Genealogy Fair. I hope that you'll stay with us for all 3 days. Since we have a very tight schedule, the speaker may not be able to answer all of your questions during this session, the 10-minute Q&A. So please reach out to us via email at inquire@nara.gov. For captioning, go to Virtual Genealogy Fair and click on the link for today. Another note for you is that lectures will be recorded and posted on our Virtual Genealogy Fair by the end of November. If you're just tuning in, this is session number 2. The lecture is entitled Preserving Your Family, Your Personal Records, and our speaker is Marylynn Ritzenthaler. She will explain how to preserve family papers and photographs, how to safely mount them, and how to frame and display them. She will discuss the factors that cause damage to paper and photographs and how to store them in an environment that makes for a safe, enduring project that you can keep your family papers together forever. Marylynn Ritzenthaler is the chief of the Conservation Laboratory at the National Archives at College Park. And I'm now going to turn the microphone over to Marylynn.
Thank you, Diane. I'm very happy to be able to talk about one of my favorite topics this morning. Preservation of almost everything is of great interest to people who work in archives and libraries, and we have a special affinity for people who have precious collections of family papers, records, documents, which can be inclusive of almost anything. Diaries, photographs, Bibles, much beloved books or textbooks, and even such things as drawings by school children. And as you can see from this image, which is a kind of childish drawing by one of my nieces, it's certainly not high art, but it represents the kinds of things that all of us treasure. And they seem to take on even more significance as time goes by. So as Diane mentioned, we're going to be discussing a number of topics this morning that will help you to preserve the items that you are wishing to pass down to future generations. The basic preservation steps that you should think about are actually the same kinds of activities that people who work in archives and libraries undertake to preserve their holdings for future generations. These basic categories of activity include having a good environment that is suitable for the collections that people are wishing to preserve, to make sure that non-damaging storage materials are used, such things as boxes and folders, to make sure that any handling is carefully done and is actually limited, because it's during that point of active interaction with materials that there can be accidental damage. Photographs can be fingerprinted, documents can be smudged or torn. So limiting handling is a very basic preservation step. Limited display is another important preservation concern, because we know that items that have been exhibited for a long period of time can show damage from excessive exposure to light. Inks can fade, photographs can also lose some of their color content or can fade as well. A really basic and perhaps kind of odd way to think about preservation is to use your nose. If you can smell something, that usually is a good clue that something is happening. And perhaps that something is not what you would like in terms of the impact on your collections. For example, your nose might tell you that you're smelling something like mold or mildew. That's especially bad for paper-based collections. You might also smell some kind of a chemical odor if you have photographic materials that are film-based, and for example, you smell something that smells like vinegar. That will be a really good clue that you need to look at your negatives and determine whether or not you have unstable film that is degrading. So just as with archives and libraries, the environment is probably the greatest area where we focus our attention because we are attempting to benefit all materials by providing a stable temperature and relative humidity and to eliminate or minimize exposure to light sources because all of these are factors that can enhance the degradation of collection materials. If you think back to high school or college chemistry, you will know that if you add heat or moisture to an interaction, that will increase the rate of chemical change. And that is what we want to avoid with paper-based collections because high temperature, high relative humidity will accelerate the degradation of such things as papers and photographic materials. High temperature and relative humidity also will encourage the growth of mold or mildew, and also will create an environment that is especially conducive to certain kinds of insects. And we want to keep those sorts of critters well away from our collections. So what you should do at home is to do what archives and libraries try to do in their institutions, which is to try to provide a storage environment that is cool and dry, and also dark storage is good because it will avoid problems with excessive exposure to light. The other things that you want to avoid are light sources such as ultraviolet radiation, skylights, and incandescent lights because they contain a high amount of what is known as UV or ultraviolet light. This is the very active part of the light spectrum and can cause damage such as light fading of inks and other media such as watercolors. It can also cause poor quality papers to become brittle and yellowed and difficult to handle. Pollutants is not perhaps something that you think of as anything that you have to worry about in a home environment, but we actually all have a lot of things that we should be careful about avoiding. If you are using, for example, untreated wood, like in bookcases or file cabinets, they can off-gas peroxides and formaldehyde, and these are very active gases that can cause degradation of collection materials. Other sources of pollutants in the home could be cleaning supplies or products that might contain ammonia. And finally, another area where you could have problems with off-gassing of unstable materials would be if you are using unstable or poor quality housing materials such as boxes. I bet almost everybody uses shoe boxes to store papers and photographs, and oftentimes those will seem to fare okay, but you need to know that that is not the best storage solution and that poor quality cardboard is likely to damage paper and photos over time. So to kind of recap what I've been talking about in terms of the environment, you want to avoid storing papers and photographs near sources of heat or moisture, and that would include such things as radiators, heat vents, or even pipes that might have a leak or have some kind of water event associated with them, maybe a slow drip over time that you wouldn't notice. Also avoid storing things that you care about in attics, basements, or garages. Space is tight for all of us, but these sorts of environments typically can get really hot in the summertime. They can be hot and dry, which will cause materials to dry out and become brittle, or they might be susceptible to high levels of moisture, say if a basement leaks. The same sort of thing or consideration that you would want to consider in terms of where to store things in your home might also apply if you have a many things, a really large collection, and are thinking about using some kind of a rented storage area. There are a lot of commercial companies that provide this capability for us, but be really cautious when you are putting precious materials in a place that you are not constantly available to make sure that things are going to be going as you expect. Even places that say they have you know, 24/7 air conditioning, etc. So really the bottom line is that conditions that are moderate, essentially comfortable for people, are also going to be suitable for storing most papers, books, and photographs. There are a number of problems, preservation problems, that are posed by paper depending upon the age of the paper, the way it was made, and the kind of paper fiber that was used, and also chemicals that perhaps were added during the processing. I think everyone is familiar with newsprint or newspaper, which was really made for short-term ephemeral use. And what we try to do in archives and libraries is to basically fight nature. We're trying to preserve for the long term very unstable materials, which is why many institutions tend to do some kind of copying. In the past, that used to be microfilm projects with newspapers. Now it would likely be digital imaging. So in some ways, you are fighting nature because what you're trying to preserve was not really made or intended to last for centuries. Those of you who have newspapers delivered, perhaps they will sit out in the driveway or on the front walk for even a day or two, you will begin to see the results of poor environmental conditions. Sunlight, heat, moisture, all of those things are going to cause some changes in the paper. Sunlight will cause the paper to darken because it's poor quality to begin with, so you will end up with paper that is weak and brittle. So that's kind of a way of accelerated aging, and the kind of thing that you want to avoid in your permanent storage location. Mold and insects are another kind of bane of preservation. We don't like to have these things around no matter what, but especially when we're trying to preserve things like papers and photographs, they can cause permanent damage, loss of information. Insects can tunnel through pages of a book, making it very lacy and hard to handle. Mold can cause staining, can obscure text, and mold also is going to be able to digest paper, creating losses, causing pages to stick together. And pests such as rodents and squirrels will sometimes like to use paper from documents and books. They shred it and use it as a nesting material. So none of these are good for papers and books, and they're not especially good for kind of human health issues as well. So it's another thing to think about when you consider where you're going to be putting your collections, and another good reason to avoid places such as attics, basements, and garages. One of the important ways that you can preserve your collection and also make it accessible over time is to store items properly. And you can really follow the lead of archives and libraries, which have developed systems to make it easy to handle, to label, and to access collections. Typically, institutions use a variety of enclosures, folders, and document boxes that are non-acidic and that have an alkaline reserve. And these chemical properties will make it less likely that the materials themselves will cause any damage to your collection over time. It's important to think about selecting items of the right size. For example, if you have papers that are largely letter size, then you should select folders and boxes and any other enclosures that will match that size. You can also purchase standard legal or oversized enclosures as well. But the goal of housing is to make sure that you can safely handle and access things without causing damage. You don't want edges of paper to be sticking out because those edges will become caught, perhaps tear and break off. So you want support as well as full enclosure. Folders and boxes also make it possible to easily store things, to write names and other kinds of identifying information on folders, so that all of the research that you have been doing on your family history is going to be saved, and it will be easier for people to find exactly what they're looking for, which is another important preservation rule, which is to limit excess handling. So by doing good storage and good labeling, you will be able to enhance that process. Photographic materials pose some issues and problems that are a little bit different than paper. There are so many different kinds of photos that have been created over time, and the technology of creating photos today is really radically changing. Oftentimes, though, we're dealing with historical processes. You might have daguerreotypes in your collection, or tintypes, or albumen prints, or you may have a lot of black and white photographs. What you should do is look at those and see whether or not there is any evidence of loss or damage, and then try to think about ways in which you can properly handle and store these materials. Some examples of problems with black and white photographs might be yellowing and staining, and this is typically a result of the initial way that the photos were processed, and residual processing chemicals were not washed out during that processing. For good or ill, chemical processing of photographs is much less the norm these days. People are tending to use digital imaging and digital hard copy when they print things out. If you see some kind of shiny metallic sheen on black and white photographs, know that that is known as silvering out. And it's really a result of oxygen coming into contact with the silver. It doesn't really obscure information. You can kind of move the photo one way or the other to try to see the image more completely. And there's not a whole lot that you can do about it. But it's something that photo conservators are very much aware of. Color photographs, including school photographs and group shots of picnics and church events, can be wonderful memories and treasures. The problem with color photographs is that over time, many of the different color processes, the dyes became unstable, they shift, they fade. Sometimes you'll see photos that look all magenta or all blue. And again, there's not much that you can do to reverse that damage, but you can make copies of things so at least you can preserve access to information. Another potential problem with photographic materials is the way that they were mounted historically. Oftentimes they were put on pretty decorative cardboard supports or mounts. Oftentimes those mounts contain very helpful information that can help you to identify the date a photograph was taken, if it was done commercially, the name of the photographer, that sort of thing. These paper mounts and supports are sometimes weak and brittle, but what they're doing is really giving you a little border or margin for you to safely handle the photos. You want to protect the mounts because they really are that protective layer that is supporting the photographs. We are really in the digital age, and with digital photography, there is a whole lot that has changed in terms of how we are preserving and capturing our visual memories. But with digital prints in particular, there are a lot of stability issues given the different kinds of printing technologies. Some of them are not light sensitive. Some of them are very moisture reactive. And I think in some cases, people are thinking of any hard copy print or output as a convenience copy, and their electronic file is really what they're concerned with preserving. So I'm going to tell you a secret, and that is your speaker, me, is one of the people pictured in this photograph, and I'm not going to tell you which one, but she's wearing shorts. So, again, continue with our topic on photographs. As with paper, cool storage is really recommended. That will prolong the useful life of photos, will make it possible to access information over time, and it can be a little bit more difficult than in a home environment that it is in an archive to provide a cool or cold vault for photos. But you can pick the part of your house that is coolest, avoiding the basement though. And also make sure that you have air conditioning, a dehumidifier, anything that's going to help to preserve the photos for as long as possible. With unstable materials, such as color in particular, copying or scanning to protect the originals is really an important preservation tool or step. I'd like to recommend that you take some time to visit the website of the Image Permanence Institute. They have been doing amazing work for many years on a whole lot of issues that relate to the preservation of photographic materials. I mentioned earlier that if you smell something like vinegar and you have some film negatives, you might be dealing with cellulose acetate film. They have a whole lot of very helpful information on film materials. They also have been doing work for many years on digital prints and digital photography. So you have the website here, and I do highly recommend that you take advantage of all of the preservation information that is available there. So storing photographs is a little bit different than storing documents and paper-based records. Typically, you want to have separate storage from between paper and photographs. So if you, for example, have a series of letters, diaries, and then a group of photographs, separate storage is really going to be best so that you can provide the unique storage needs for the photo materials. Commercially, there are a wide range of envelopes, sleeves, folders that are available that you can purchase that meet preservation requirements. There are some safe plastics that you can select, and the good thing about plastic material is that they provide immediate visual access. You don't have to actually handle the photograph in order to see the content. If you are using a paper enclosure, such as an envelope or a sleeve, that means that you have to slide the photograph in and out of its enclosure in order to actually look at it. And that can be a problem both in terms of potentially fingerprinting the photo and also the potential for abrasion that could occur as you are moving the photo in and out of its paper sleeve. There are some safe plastics that you can try to acquire. Polyester, polyethylene, and polypropylene are all suitable, and they are fabricated into different kinds of formats and designs to accommodate 4x5 photographs and negatives, 35mm slides, virtually anything that you need to store. There will be sizes commercially available in these plastic materials. There is something to avoid. There are a lot of things to avoid. But in the context of storage for photos, you want to avoid a plastic that is called polyvinyl chloride, or PVC. And everyone who has ever sat in a new car, luckily, knows what that smells like. It is a very strong odor. And what happens is PVC degrades is that the plasticizer that is in the plastic that helps the film to be flexible starts to come out. It can form droplets that stick directly to the photos and can cause the photos to stick to the enclosure. Unfortunately, when you look at two pieces of plastic, it's very hard to tell them apart. How do you know what is good and safe? How do you know what is not really suitable over time? Which is the reason that it's important to purchase suppliers, for photos and actually all of your collections from reputable suppliers that sell to archives and libraries. And we have provided a list of some of those. If you look through catalogs of various vendors, they will say that some of their products pass what is called the photographic activity test, which is important, and you can also learn more about the PAT on the website for the Image Permanence Institute. So supplies that pass the PAT have been determined to be safe for long-term storage of photos. So here's an array of acid-free envelopes, the kind that are sold for storing photographic materials. And they can be great. You can write on the paper, you can do captions or name the people who are pictured in a photo. But as I mentioned, there are some potential problems because you can't see what's inside the envelope, which means you have to pull the photo in and out. That could cause some abrasion. If you have a damaged photograph where you have emulsion that is lifting or maybe edges that are tattered and torn, they could catch on the envelope as you pull it in and out. And there can also be just surface abrasion that could occur if people don't handle things safely. Some of the historic versions of envelopes tended to have adhesives that would hold the paper enclosure together, and oftentimes that adhesive seam was right down the middle. So if you come across storage enclosures for photos that have adhesive, make sure that those seams are along the side or the bottom. You don't want it down the center, because if there is any chemical reaction between the photo and the seam, you don't want that to be smack in the middle of your photographic image. It's a little hard to tell on this slide that these two photos are being protected by polyester sleeves. But polyester is one of those stable plastics that I mentioned that is suitable for the long-term storage of photos as well as for paper. Archives and libraries tend to use this material a lot for anything where they don't want the surface to be touched or handled directly. Also for items that are weak and brittle because it gives a little bit of extra support. The nice thing for photographic materials, though, is that polyester sleeve provides immediate visual access to the image with no handling and no removing it for viewing. The other thing you can do with polyester, which is a great boon, is you can do imaging right through the polyester film. So if you are photographing or digitizing your collection to share with other relatives, you don't have to remove the photo from the sleeve. You can get a good shot right through the plastic. I bet a lot of you have photographic albums, those wonderful historic assemblages. Oftentimes they are made with black mounting paper and use photo corners. Sometimes the captions are written in white ink, sometimes with a wavery hand, perhaps. Photo albums have gotten a bad rap over the years. People think that they are bad, they're not good for the photos, and in some cases that can be true, especially for things that have been handled a lot or that have been put together with poor quality adhesives that cause damage to the photos, including staining. And sometimes images will fall off of a mounting page, and that can cause some handling issues. But in general, people tend to think that albums are special treasures that should be preserved in their original format because they represent the worldview of the person who put them together, the sequence of the images, and the caption information, all in one wonderful package that might be a preservation challenge, but it is probably a challenge that is worth taking. So mostly in archives and libraries, we tend to respect the original structures and albums and to try to do our best to preserve them in their original format. One way to do this is to make copies so that you can use the copies as your access tool and to set the original photos and albums away for safe storage. There are an amazing array of products out in the marketplace for storing photographic materials. If you go to a craft store or an art supply store, you will find a ton of things that they advertise as being suitable for storing your treasures, but you really need to think about whether that's true and what business they're really in. Something called magnetic albums, which is a funny phrase because there are no magnets involved, but there are some sticky papers that are overlaid with clear plastic film, and you lift that film and you position your photos and they stay in place. So I guess that is either the magic or the magnetic part, hard to tell. But a lot of the albums that you can purchase are made with poor quality papers. They are using adhesives that can cause staining and that lose their adhesive properties over time, which means that photographs or other items that are mounted will fall to the bottom or fall out and become damaged. And the unknown plastics that many of them contain can be unstable and cause yellowing and also adhere directly to the photos. It is possible, again, going to vendors that specialize in selling to historical societies, archives, and libraries to purchase preservation quality albums. Again, these are going to be made of good quality papers and plastics, the polyester or polyethylene, and no adhesives typically are required because they have sleeves that have been fabricated with seals to accommodate 4x5 prints. Whatever size photo you have, it's likely that you will be able to find an album page that would go into a ring binder like this that can accommodate many different formats of photos. So, we have things that we love and we want to share them. And typically that means we put things out on tables or on the piano. And that's not a bad thing, but you do need to think about what can happen to items that are over exhibited. You do need to limit light exposure. We talked briefly about problems with light, the fact that light can cause fading and darkening of certain kinds of materials. So you want to avoid sunlight and fluorescent light. Fluorescent typically isn't found in a home environment, but both sunlight and fluorescent light contain high levels of UV or ultraviolet radiation that can cause things like photos to fade, manuscript inks to fade, as well as watercolor drawings, if you have those. And also limit the incandescent lighting, which is the old-fashioned Edison light bulb. Those don't contain much in the way of ultraviolet radiation, but they can raise the heat. And remember that we're trying to create a moderate environment with relatively low temperature and low relative humidity. So if you have something that's on display, there are some clues that you can think about that will tell you that damage either has or is occurring and that you might want to take something off exhibit. With documents, notice if there is some yellowing or darkening, some kind of staining that is taking place. If you have signatures that are fading away to almost invisibility, or photos that have that metallic sheen, which was known as silver mirroring, that are darkened or cracked, or color photographs that have shown some change in color. In institutions, we take special care in documenting how long we display items because we know that excess light and excess exposure during display can cause change that is irreversible. So at home, if you have special items, think about doing that also. Find a place where you can display things, maybe in a darkened hallway where you might pass it by, but it's not going to be struck by light. And keep track of how long you have something on exhibit. Oops. There are some tools that we have that institutions use, and you should as well, and that is to, rather than displaying your original photo or letter from Aunt Lucy, make a color photocopy. Color photocopies can make really great facsimiles, and sometimes they are scary in terms of how good they look. You can also make a digital scan and print that and use that for exhibition. That way you can put the original materials in dark storage while still having access to the information or the beautiful items that you would like to be able to see more regularly. If you are going to be displaying things in a window mat and a frame, there are some basic preservation considerations to keep in mind. Any kind of backing board or window mat should be made of high-quality materials, very similar to the kinds of materials that you would select for your folders and your boxes. So you want to make sure that you are using non-acidic boards sometimes referred to as acid-free. Oftentimes, mat board will be referred to as museum mounting board. But again, you want to purchase these supplies from reputable suppliers. You can go to an art supply store oftentimes and ask for mat board that is suitable. So acid-free mounting boards, backing boards, and also think about adhesives, knowing that in the context of albums, adhesives are often the source of a lot of preservation problems because they can cause staining and discoloration. So any mounting that you do should not have any adhesive coming into direct contact with your documents or with your photos. In terms of the concern over light exposure, you can purchase, rather than using plain window glass as the glazing in the frame, you can purchase UV filtering plexi, which will filter out some of the ultraviolet light. That will buy you some measure of protection, but don't think of it as a forever solution because you still want to limit the amount of overall display. So we're not talking years. One way to avoid applying any adhesive to your documents is to use plastic or paper photo corners. These are made either of polyester film, which is that stable plastic that I keep referring to, or to acid-free paper. They come with a pressure-sensitive tape on the back, so it doesn't come into contact with the document. And again, these can be purchased from the suppliers that sell products to archives and libraries. What you want to avoid are pressure-sensitive tapes, different kinds of sticky tapes, Scotch brand tapes, masking tape, any kind of glue, such as Elmer's or PVA, polyvinyl acetate. If you go to places like craft stores or art supply stores, you might see adhesives that are described as acid-free, or they use that word archival, but it doesn't really mean anything. It's an advertising claim, but those products can, in fact, cause damage over time. Rubber cement is especially terrible, and if you have any historic albums in your custody, you probably will see examples of rubber cement, which oftentimes will result in really heavy, darkened yellow stains and with photos falling off of their pages because it doesn't stick forever. Any kind of adhesives that are used with hot glue guns are good adhesives to avoid. So we all have treasured books, whether these are childhood books, family Bibles, diaries, copybooks, things that we really want to keep, maybe access on a periodic basis, but be able to pass on to future generations. It's really important to try to keep books in their original format. Books that are much loved often show that love because they have been used. Covers might be abraded, spines might be off, covers might be missing. But whatever you have, you should try to keep those remnants. And one good way to keep them and protect them is to put them into some kind of a box or a wrapper. That will protect items from exposure to light and dirt, and also will help to keep any components together, especially if you have loose boards or loose spines. This is an example of a four-flap, what is called a phase box, and you can purchase these in a variety of standard sizes that can then be folded and scored to fit the dimensions of your volumes. You might not want to go that far, but it's a possibility. If you do have damaged volumes, remember the rule about don't use adhesives, don't use masking tape or other kinds of pressure-sensitive tapes to hold those covers on. Volumes or books should be stored away from sources of light because you want to keep the spines and the covers from fading. You can store books according to size so that they can support one another while they're in storage. That means don't intersperse tall and short books because they'll tend to slump and to bend over. If you have really large volumes, such as albums or atlases, they are better off stored flat. Remember back to when we were talking about pollutants and things to avoid. If you are using wooden bookshelves, sometimes that wood is not coated or sealed, and that means that any kind of impurities in the wood, such as formaldehyde, can leach out and can cause some damage. That's of a special concern on unsealed bookcases or if you are using wooden filing cabinets. Now, this can be a problem if you are also an antique lover because you want to store your favorite collections in your beautiful antiques. But you need to think about the kind of the interaction between the two, and perhaps at least you could put some kind of a barrier on your shelves or in the drawers that are wooden, thinking back to polyester film, which has so many uses in thinking about preservation. Oftentimes, people have oversized items. In archives and libraries, that can be maps and posters and drawings, also things like panorama photographs. And they can really baffle all of us in terms of what is safe and suitable storage that is also going to permit easy access that will not be damaging. If you have a panorama photograph of your, class reunion, say, I will say from 1912, but I think that's too early for most of us here. They can be, 10 or 12 feet long, and most of us just don't have storage furniture that will accommodate that. So rolling is one solution that institutions use to provide safe storage. It's important to make sure that the tube that you are using to wrap the item onto is stable, non-acidic, and you want to roll the item so that you are rolling face in terms of the image. Once something is rolled, you can protect the object from light exposure by wrapping it in a good quality acid-free paper, such as Permalife. And then you can add a secondary layer of polyester film or polyethylene, and what that will do is to provide any protection against moisture, elevated relative humidity, or perhaps a leaky pipe. A lot of us have different kinds of sound recordings, audio tapes, videotapes, and they can be a real preservation challenge. Oftentimes, we are concerned not only with the media itself, but with the unavailability of equipment to do the playback. Machine obsolescence is a really big factor for repositories and also for you if you're trying to preserve, family mementos that are audio or gatherings where people have done videotapes. Typically what people are doing nowadays is to try to make copies of these, and the way that is being done primarily is through digitizing them. There are similar issues with electronic media. Files can be saved to do some kind of backup. You don't want to rely on only one image. And this is also an area where you need to think about what advertising claims might be, because a lot of the backup CDs that are recommended are claimed to be archival. In fact, archival in the industry might mean 5 to 10 years. So in this whole area of electronic, audio, and video, inspection is a really important part of preserving because you want to make sure that there haven't been changes that have occurred. You always want to have some kind of a backup available. Don't rely on just your one, perhaps fragile, original. And know that for long-term persistence, you need to make sure that your files are periodically copied. Labeling CDs and DVDs is typically not recommended, but if you feel that you must do it, you should use a solvent-free marker on the side that is not being read. And it's perfectly fine to store all of these materials in the original polypropylene cases in which they are acquired. If you have items in your collection that are warranted for some kind of conservation intervention, there is a referral service that is offered by the American Institute for Conservation. This is a free service, and you can go to their website, which is on this slide, and for your geographic area and for the kind of materials that you are concerned with preserving, you can get the names of book, paper, photo, textile conservators in your geographic area and engage with them for some kind of a consultation or perhaps treatment if that is what is needed. The National Archives, of course, is a fabulous source of information on all things archival and all things preservation, and we hope that you will go to our website and also look at our preservation pages for specific information on your areas of interest.
You have a lot of questions from Twitter regarding the pH for paper. Paper is supposed to be a base. What is the best pH environment for photographs?
Well, most historically processed photographs, things that were processed by chemical means, are actually acidic. Good quality photo papers are typically of good quality, but the enclosures that we use for storing photo materials are normally the paper, if we're using paper rather than plastic, the paper is non-acidic and it's alkaline with a pH probably between 7.5 and 9.
Okay, thank you. A question from YouTube. Our Historical Society has an original 1859 map of Waldo County, Maine in our holdings, but it is in a poor state at this time. Is there a process that you can apply to such a map to stabilize the map?
That map might benefit from conservation treatment depending upon the condition. What we will always want to do is to preserve as much as remains of anything. And so sometimes even putting something into a good storage system, it might be to put it on a piece of good quality map board and then in a large folder will provide rigid support, would permit it to be handled. It probably would also be a good idea if you don't have a copy of that map is to somehow acquire one. Even a handheld digital camera could probably give you a copy that you would be able to use and access rather than the original. But treatment is a possibility, and you could consult the American Institute for Conservation for any conservators in your region that might be able to do a consultation and provide some assistance. It sounds like a great treasure.
Thank you. Another question from Twitter. Is it better to take photos out of a family Bible from the early 1900s or leave them in it?
That is a dilemma, isn't it? I could actually see that question being answered both ways because there is something about the context that is interesting and provides some information. But probably for the greatest preservation benefit, it would be a good idea to remove the photos from the volume or from the Bible. You could always annotate the pages that they came from if that was of significance. But photos will do best if they are stored separately from other materials. If you have any evidence of staining, either between the paper and the photos, sometimes if you see like a newspaper clipping that has been stored in a Bible, you will see what is known as acid migration occurring because that poor quality newsprint will stain the adjacent paper. So you might see a phenomenon like that with any photos that are stored within a Bible as well.
Okay, next question from YouTube. What is the best way to slow the damage to photos and papers caused by ammonia?
Could you repeat that, please?
What is the best way to slow the damage to photos and papers that has been caused by ammonia?
Well, certainly removing the materials from the source would be a good thing. I'm not sure I totally understand. So oftentimes damage that has occurred for any chemical reason is not easily reversed. Damage has happened. If anyone has had the privilege of coming to the National Archives and has seen the Declaration of Independence that's on exhibit, you will note that the ink is very faded. And unfortunately, that is damage that has occurred that cannot be reversed. So it is likely the case that anything that has been exposed to a chemical, I would think that ammonia might cause the paper to become brittle, So storage with some kind of rigid support or use of folders might help, making copies, but often chemical damage cannot be reversed. You just have to accept it and then find solutions for access and handling.
Thank you. From Twitter, any tips for preserving scrapbooks that include a variety of types of items?
Scrapbooks are often best stored flat because they do contain a lot of materials, and sometimes they're bulky, sometimes the adhesives holding them to the mounting page have failed and they want to fall off the pages. If they sift to the bottom during upright storage, there's likely to be damage or loss. So flat storage is really best in a box if you can acquire it. I would say always with things like albums and scrapbooks, if there is a way for you to safely make a good copy that will provide a visual record of the assemblage, that is a good thing to do for preservation.
Thank you. Again, from YouTube, the plastic sleeves available at Staples that say they are archival quality, is that assertion reliable? How can we test it?
It's really, really hard to test, to look at plastic and know for sure what it is, or to test it in a home environment. I personally would probably not purchase sleeves from Staples, even if they say archival. You need to know that archival doesn't have any quantitative qualities that are associated with that word. It's a word that makes us feel good, that we're buying something that is going to be suitable over time. But it's probably best to purchase your supplies from the kinds of companies that most libraries and archives will purchase from.
Thank you. Again, YouTube, we have a lot of questions now from YouTube. If you have a very old family history book that is coming apart, would one just take it out long enough to scan it and put it away again?
One could do that. That would be one way. That would limit handling and you would still have access to the information. Any kind of scanning of a book or an album, you need to think about the scanning process to make sure that the process of obtaining your image is not going to damage the binding, because oftentimes people have a tendency to want things to be as flat as possible, and that can crack bindings. So usually it's recommended that books, albums, scrapbooks, if they're imaged, that imaging be done face up. That can be done with a handheld camera. There is another tool out there that you could think about if you are interested in trying to find a duplicate copy of it, say on a Libris. That's another way to go.
Thank you. You mentioned not to tape pages. How do you keep torn pages from getting more damage if you can't tape them?
I think you must be talking about loose pages like documents or letters. And the polyester sleeves that were recommended for use with photographic materials are something that we use all the time if we have paper that is torn or brittle and weak. It is non-damaging, there's no adhesive involved, and you can avoid having to use any kind of tape, which we know can be problematic.
Thank you. Now we have three questions from YouTube about magnetic albums. We all have those, so here we go. How do I safely remove photographs from the magnetic album?
That can be a challenge depending upon the condition of the photographs, how long they have been on those pages. If you are lucky and the forces are with you, it may be that you will be able to gently remove them. I would not lift up a corner of the photograph and try to start prying it or lifting it away, because what that is likely to do is to cause a lot of little lines or striations in the photo. It's going to actually cause some damage. What you could do is to try and take a very thin and flexible palette knife from an art supply store and begin to put that between the back of the photo and the mounting page to see if that will let the photo release. If it doesn't, I think it's just really important to watch what you're doing and to stop if there's any sign of damage. And if there is, that might be when you would want to make contact with a photo conservator.
Thank you. We have one last question. Because your magnetic description was so thorough, you answered three questions in one. So next is, how can I preserve 8mm and super 8mm film and be able to view it as projectors are now obsolete? I have hundreds of rolls of it.
You know, I work with paper and books and photos. My specialty is not film. But if you go to the National Archives website, there is a lot of really excellent information on preservation of film and audio materials and other sorts of non-text materials. Probably you're going to need to locate a commercial source who could copy that material for you. And digitizing is what most people and institutions are doing, with the recognition that that generates really large files that have to be stored.
Thank you, Marylynn. If our speaker did not get to your questions, please send an email to inquire@nara.gov. We'll now have a short intermission and we'll resume at noon with a presentation about when saying I do meant giving up your U.S. citizenship. Thank you.